Hi, welcome to Monuments of Modulation 3, Livin' on a Prayer. We're talking about Bon Jovi, 1986, Slippery When Wet. Bon Jovi, kind of the Jersey boy, he's kind of trying to do a Bruce Springsteen kind of lyrical thing in this song, except where Bruce Springsteen points and hints, John Bon Jovi spells it all out. Sorry, Bon Jovi, you're not quite the poet that the boss is. Few are. The song is great. The modulation is one of my favorites ever. There's a couple aspects about it that I'm going to talk about that I love. It happens after the guitar solo. But let's get there. So we got this intro. I'm just going to kind of follow the bass line here. We got this intro. We're in the key of E minor, P.S. The intro kind of got this E minor chord mostly, but then it sometimes hits a C chord and a D chord. The submedian and the subtonic chords. It happens a few times. So we've got that E minor chord going. C chord, D chord. That's an E minor chord, a C chord, and a D chord in the intro. Now we got the verses coming up. And in the verses, we're going to end up having four bars of E minor, two, three, four, one bar of C, one bar of D, two more bars of E minor. All going to repeat. So E minor chord for four bars, C chord for a bar, D chord for a bar, back to an E minor chord. Let's get this pre-chorus part. This happens three times. Then this happens for a bar. This happens for a bar. I want to stop there. We're still in the key of E minor. This is a 6 chord and a 7 chord. Still a 7 chord and a 1 chord. That happens three times, and then the C chord is stretched out more, and the D chord is stretched out more. Go ahead and write these in letter names too for everybody who likes letter names. This is what I would call the pre-chorus of the song, because it happens before the chorus. There's something I also want to point out. I don't want to not point out this rhythmic motif. For love, we'll give it a shot. This triplet, give it a shot. Quarter note triplets. Then there's that snare hit in there too. It's kind of like the harbinger. Am I using that word right? The harbinger of the chorus. Every time the chorus is about to happen, you hear that. It's cool. Is it cool? I don't know. Maybe it's not cool. I like it. The pre-chorus, the chorus, the intro, the verse. We haven't got to the chorus yet. We will. But let's go back to the verse and talk harmonic functions for a little bit. So, in classical music, we have our three harmonic functions, tonic, predominant, and dominant. And if we were in E minor in classical music, or lots of pop music too, a C is a totally normal chord to play as a predominant chord. However, if we were in classical music or lots of kinds of pop music, the actual dominant chord for E minor would be either a B chord or a D sharp diminished chord. We have a D chord, the subtonic triad, the major chord that lies a whole step below the tonic. I'm still gonna say it's working as a dominant chord though. And this is something I didn't make up, but a lot of people who talk about pop music theory talk about how in pop music the subtonic triad ends up having a dominant function. And we think about our functions with our feelings, like tonic feels like home, right? It's like the gravitational center, safe, home. When you get to a predominant chord, it's like you've stepped away from home. You're not in Kansas anymore, Toto. And then when you get to a dominant chord, you're highly directed and highly motivated to come back to tonic. A predominant chord doesn't feel like it has to go anywhere. It could go to some other predominant chord. It's not super motivated to go any particular place. Dominant chords, dominant areas, the dominant function is very directed. It has a very definite destination, and that destination is tonic. And this is really normal, right? We get these harmonic phrases. Every time the verse happens, we have this extension of the tonic, predominant, dominant, back to the tonic. The verses feel pretty safe. They feel pretty like they don't take many risks. You know, they're 8 bars, they're super even, we get the predominant. And then things accelerate. The harmonic rhythm accelerates. Until now, there's never been a chord change that was quicker than a bar. In the pre-chorus, the chords changes start coming every half a bar, except for this dominant one lasts for 2 different half a bars, so a whole bar. Anyhow, speeds up the harmonic rhythm, slows it back down before we get the da-na-na-na, the triplet. But we're still having this tonic dominant thing. Okay, let's talk about the chorus. In the chorus, we get the first hint of the kind of thing that's gonna happen when we get to the cool modulation. So in the chorus, we have an E chord for about half a bar, C chord for about half a bar, D chord for 2 bars, a G chord for half a bar, a C chord for half a bar, a D chord for 2 bars. That's pretty much our chorus progression. In the key of E minor, which we're still in, that'd be a 1 chord, a 6 chord, and a 7 chord. And then a 3 chord, and a 6 chord, and a 7 chord. And what I think is helping us get ready for the modulation here, and also helping the chorus feel the way it feels, is that this subtonic way of doing dominant, right? Before now I was saying the 7 was always acting like a dominant chord. Well, if D was acting like a normal dominant chord, it'd be the dominant chord of the key of G. And in fact, you can kind of hear this as a 5 going to a 1. Now this is the point of the chorus, like, whoa, we're halfway there, whoa! It's kind of the high point of the high point, if you get what I mean. It's the whoa! This whoa is like so strong. It feels like in G major, a 5-to-1. It feels like a real arrival. And then as we go the second time through the chorus, you can almost hear this as a 4 chord and a 5 chord in the key of G. And therefore hear the move from this 5 chord back around to this E minor chord as a deceptive resolution to a 6 chord. You can kind of hear both of these simultaneously, try it. Now I'm in G maybe, I don't know. Back to E minor. Maybe so. Okay, then we got a little interlude. Then we have another verse, another pre-chorus, and another chorus. After the chorus, there's a guitar solo that mostly follows along with the chorus, except the last time through, this bar is replaced by a bar of E minor. This last bar of the chorus. And that's where I want to pick things up. Let's listen to that solo. Richie Sambora, 1986. And then we'll talk about the bridge, or what some people call the middle 8. So here we go. Instead of a D chord here, there's this E minor chord, and then this part. Whoa, what the heck happened? Let's go back. Oh my lord, something crazy happened there. For one thing, count those beats again. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. This bar only had 3 beats. Can you believe it? I can. And this was a D chord, but it was only 3 beats long. So in the key of E minor, which we're in, 6, 7, still 7, 1, 6 stretched out, 7 stretched out. This is a lot like when 6 and 7 got stretched out in the pre-chorus. And in fact, we also, just like in the pre-chorus, have the triplet quarter notes. Give it a shot. And when he's singing those, he's singing, we gotta hold on, ready or not, live for the fight, basically on a G there, when that's all that you got, basically on an A here. And then the next part, this is crazy. We're not in E minor anymore. No, in fact, we have modulated up a minor third. P.S. Just, oops, I wrote my key signature poorly. Fair disclosure, a minor key modulating up a minor third is my personal favorite kind of modulation. Also we're back in 4-4. This bar missed a beat. We got there a tiny bit early. It really jolts some energy into here. And suddenly we're in the key of G minor. And in the key of G minor, we end up just doing the chorus as usual. The same way we've been doing the chorus, where we go G minor now. Actually, let me write this down here. G minor, we have a 1 chord, a 6 chord, which is an E flat chord, an F chord, and then a B flat chord, an E flat chord, and an F chord. And it just keeps repeating this chorus in this new key until the end of the song. 1, 6, 7. 3, 6, 7. And just like before, we can kind of hear this 3 to 6, or this 7 to 3 rather, as a 5 to 1. In this case, the key in which we could hear this would be the key of B flat. And in the key of B flat, this would be a 4 and a 5. And this would be the 6. And this guy here is the 4 again. And I'm gonna move this B flat over here because that makes more sense. Same exact thing that was happening in the first chorus where we could hear it in E minor or G. Same thing here. And we have this smooth step up. You live for the fight when that's all that you got. Oh, G, A, B flat. It outlined the do, re, mi of the new key going into it. I think that helps it be a little smoother than it could be, but it is a heck of a jolt. Suddenly we're in the key of G minor. And how did we do it? Well, we did it the exact same way. The chorus itself is weird. If you remember the chorus, not weird, but the chorus has this great quality where you can hear this relationship, this 5 to 1 relationship in the relative major so strongly that the whole chorus progression kind of you can think of as in major. And it's because this the duality of this subtonic triad. This 7 chord can act as a dominant of the pop variety, or it can act like the real dominant, like of the classical variety. I shouldn't have said real there, that's kind of a value judgment. Amazing modulation. I always like to think about how these things go with the words. And, you know, like I said, it's kind of a Bruce Springsteen-y tale, people down on their luck. And he says, we gotta hold on, ready or not. I think the ready or not thing is like, yeah, not ready, right? We get there a beat early. I was not ready, I'm never ready. Every single time it happens, it's shocking. If you're dancing, totally screws up your dance moves. It got there a beat early, you were not ready. And you live for the fight because that's all that you got. That's a kind of depressing aspect. We just do the same shit up a minor third. We never really get to a major key. We just do the same minor shit up a minor third. That's all. Goodbye. See you next time.